Last segment, I was talking about how does one look at a work of art, one single work of art in detail, and what kind of questions one can ask when you are confronted with a work or an image, and then how by asking those multi-layered questions, you can ease out more information and more insight into the work of art. So that was the last segment framework. And in this segment, I will be talking about how, if I am looking at multiple works, how does one make a sense of the commonalities that are there between the work, and how each work, even though they are comparatively similar, there can be a lot of minute differences between the works. So that is the topic I will be covering in this segment. The idea is that the artists don't work in vacuum. The artist may be a today artist, maybe 100 years ago. So he or she never worked in a vacuum. The artist would be either trained by an art school or at an atelier, or he or she would have been trained in a traditional family where maybe stone carving is going on, painting is going on, and things like that. So invariably, the artist picks up a lot of ideas about what is art, what is not art, what is accepted, what is not accepted, and so on. So that in a way frames up the artist's mentality. So we have to look at how the time that the artist is working is shaping his or her ideas, and then the content and medium used and all that. And invariably, the artists tend to get influenced by other artists working in his or her time. And you tend to see, admire, sometimes even copy in the initial stage. And then you also have a conversation with another artist from another time. Maybe you look at a work which was made 300 years ago, you like something, and then you start using part of that language, part of that imagery, and so on. So in that sense, you're having a conversation with a historical artist. So this is a constant process. That means artist is not an island. He is giving some ideas and taking some ideas. This give and take is going on between his own or her own contemporary as well as the past art. So if I am looking at a series of works, one idea would be to go by, let's say, a theme. I start putting up 10-15 works of the same theme, and then you start looking for what is similar to them and what is dissimilar or unique. So thereby you will understand the various nuanced kind of attention that the artist gives to the detail. And theme, though you are picking up one theme, the artist can be from different time or from different geographical kind of areas, but there can be a common character which will, if I'm putting all those works together, there should be some kind of commonality so that you can compare them and study them. So when you see them together, you'll be able to learn a lot of details. If you just do a little bit of homework, you'll realize that he was actually taking this Naika series imagery from the miniature. In miniature, we have this different kind of Naikas, Ashta Naikas in fact, and the particular Naika that he is taken is Utka Naika. That means she is eager to meet the lover. And now when you see the similar kind of theme painting from another time and another geographical area, that is from the Punjab hills, then you will see a very different kind of landscape. The dressing is different, and the way the artist is dealing with the form is also different. The content is same. The content is about waiting for the lover. But the way the form is being handled, in the way Ravi Verma was influenced by the European school, the academic school that we call. So he started painting it like a kind of representational image with very close to what we saw as a photographic thing. Not exactly a photographic realism, but quite a bit of modulation was shown, the light and shade was shown, and all that. But in a miniature painting, the whole painting will be treated flat. There will be no reference to light. There is no reference to light and shadow. And you don't see very elaborate lighting like how you see. But the suggestion of the knight comes from this few darts, which is very suggestive of a knight. That is the only, but rest it looks like it's a very even kind of lighting. And then if this girl here is looking outside the frame, that means there is a very different kind of, it's almost like a photographic language, right? So the framing of the whole painting and all that, but in miniature, she is not looking outside. She is, she is introvert and she is thinking in herself, but she is waiting. And again, you will see that the kind of contrast which we saw in the mood of the character and the landscape is evident in that painting also. The painting is about blooming flowers. And then it's a time when, things bloom, but she is waiting. She is in a very contradictory kind of mood. So that the contrast in the mood between the landscape and the person who is sitting there creates a different kind of tension. Now, same kind of theme, Utkanayaka, from the oleograph printed in Ravivarma press, and then another miniature painting. Again, you will see the mood is similar. The mood is that of waiting, but the landscape changes and the treatment of the figure changes. Here again, it's a miniature kind of treatment. The whole surface is flat. There is no perspective. It's mostly line oriented kind of treatment. And because it's a Pahadi painting, you will see the hill range behind her. So that is where the questions we ask will start yielding you more and more detail about the artist, where he lived and what kind of people he was seeing and so on. And here there is a indication of a danger also. Like you will see this serpent there, and then the fact that she is oblivious of the danger brings a sense of she is so much more deeply in thought or deeply involved in waiting for the person. Here it almost looks like desperation rather than waiting, the kind of mood that is being expressed there. And then we have Pushpamala, who recreates the old imagery. It's a kind of conversation she quotes, and the way she builds up is very similar to Ravivarma image, because she has taken that as a source. The idea with Pushpamala is that she enacts an imagery from another time, another photograph, and thereby she brings our attention to how images are constructed. Every image is a construct. It is somebody, an agency or an artist is involved in creating that painting, the mood, and all the other associations which are involved with the painting. So she brings that to the fore, and this is a kind of a popular painting that is sold in the tourist spots. So all of them are very similar in theme, but only they are different in terms of detail, in terms of the language that they use, the kind of aesthetic sense they have. And here it becomes almost reductive. The pose is same, but somehow the kind of expression that you see from Ravivarma down here, it keeps shifting and it becomes little more simplified to some extent in this. Also because it is painted on a bamboo stick mat. Now, if I compare this with another painting from another place, then you will see the difference, how they all have a similar language or similar kind of imagery from one cultural sphere. And then this is also waiting, but very different kind of waiting. So it may be a good exercise to bring together similar kind of imagery, also sometimes juxtapose one to the other, so that you start seeing the kind of difference that happens when you cross the border or go to the other geographical area. I want to take up just one more set of imagery, one more set of sculptures and paintings. And the idea again is to see how, though the theme is very similar, the theme I have taken is kiss, which is such an intimate act between two people, and how does artist deal with it? And what kind of emphasis they are bringing to the subject, what kind of twist each artist is bringing. And this is Rodan, and that is the Indian sculpture from the Orissa 13th century. Also, another thing I'm trying to bring to your notice is that there are some artists who want to give you a detail of what is seen through the eye. For example, here, the Rodan sculpture, the entire what shall I say, concentration of the artist is on getting the right anatomy, the kind of proportion, the musculature, right? He is keeping her hand there, and then the muzzle has gone down a little bit in this, you will see in a much bigger image. So all these details he is interested in that, and he is conveying, okay, he is looking at this two set of people, and then he is communicating those kind of details which are seen through the eye. Now if somebody has to go beyond what is seen, then what kind of strategy would they use? That is what we have to see. This is Gustav Klimt. It's a scene of KISS, but the anatomical details are not important for him. He is in a very different kind of sphere, where it is about the celebratory mood of that moment. It's full of celebration, color and all that. And in the process, if you observe, the couple are actually subsumed and submerged in the pattern and that celebration of pattern. So it's a very different kind of worship, and he has used a lot of gold and things like that, which also brings a sense of celebration and then colorful. Marc Chagall, he brings a very emotional kind of angle to the whole act. It is when you are very elated, you are so light, you are about to float. So that kind of liveliness, that kind of emotional lightness he brings to the work. And then he has just got her a flower, and then they are kissing after meeting. So, but still he has not given up the detail of the location where they are meeting. For him, the room is important, the furniture is important, the cabinet and all the drapery. So all those details he still wants as part of his work. Perhaps he wants to locate the couple in a certain very specific context or a specific location. In the Picasso's drawing, that softness is not there. It is not about being, what we saw here, that lightness and then tenderness, that is not there. It's very, very different, very visceral, very bodily kind of expression he brings. It's almost, turbulent in its, treatment that he is doing. It brings a certain kind of animal quality to the whole drawing and the way he has distorted the human figure. This is Magritte. So Magritte brings another layer, another aspect to the fore. He says even at the most intimate moment, there is something that is not touched upon. There is some kind of secrecy that I can't reach the other person even in that intimate moment. There are some dark corners, there are some secrets. So he brings that suggestion there because he comes from this surrealist group who talk about the inner emotions and dreams and things like that. So he brings another layer to that. And finally, we come to those two images which I am very fond of, especially the Brancusi image. And now there is something called editing. And you saw that all the artists were editing something or the other. The first that we saw, Rodin, is almost like he is sculpting what he saw. But Picasso and then Chagall, everybody is trying to emphasize certain kind of detail as compared to the other. They want to maybe show you the emotional part or the kind of lustful part of the kiss and so on. And here, what Brancusi does, he simplifies the entire anatomy. He is not interested in the body, the bodily posture, and so on. So he removes all those details. That's what we call a minimalistic kind of approach. So that in a very as little detail as possible, he is trying to convey a very important point to you. One is that if you observe, both their eyes have become one, and their hairs have become similar, you can almost say one. And then other than this one line which is separating them, and then also denoting that they are man, woman, there's nothing which is separating them. So in that sense, the sense of oneness that you see in Brancusi's work, you can't see in Rodin's work. In Rodin's work, they are separate and they have a different kind of body. So the language that Brancusi uses is editing quite a bit of detail. But he's able to use that editing or what we call simplification to his advantage, so that the essential nature of the kiss as two people becoming one, almost one, that comes through more effectively. You also see the monk's kiss here, but there is a sense of melancholy in monk's kiss. I don't know if you can notice that. So the kind of oneness that I see in Brancusi's work, I don't see in monk's work. So in my mind, it's a very subjective choice again. I would rate Brancusi's work compared to all this as something which I like more. But you can choose your own imagery. So this is the kind of method one can use. You start collecting many images of similar theme, you start putting them together, and then you start observing how each artist brings a different kind of perspective to the whole imagery. So that's why I'm talking about the, you can also look at the adjacent and the opposite, are similar and dissimilar that is happening in those works. Now I move on to another aspect, that is the aspect which we saw as one specific detail in the Guernica work that we analyzed. It is the formal aspect of a work of art, because any artist has to use the tools that he has got. The tools that he has got is line, color, texture, and the way he composes or she composes the entire canvas, what kind of balance and so on. So those are understood as formal elements, and then it is not just trying to understand what those principles are, but it is interesting to understand how artists are using it as a visual strategy. If I keep an image in the center, what does it mean? If I push it to the edge, what does it mean? So that is the kind of understanding that the artist brings while using all this. We'll just come to that part. So an artist can utilize the kind of elements that he has in his hand, and then he has to think about whether there is a harmony in his work, there is unity in his work, is there enough variety, or is it becoming very monotonous, is there a certain kind of contrast that brings out the whole image. So those are the formal worries that an artist has got, and all this is to bring a sense of order. For an artist, or even for us, the experience that we go through is very chaotic. Normally you don't see an order in the outside world. But when you are doing a work of art, one needs to bring a certain sense of integrity, a certain sense of unity and an order in the work. So artists use these principles of proximity and rhythm and pattern and all that to convey those ideas. Now this is a work by John Foreman, where he collects pebbles from the beach, arranges them on the beach, and then leaves it there. But the idea is that sense of order that he is bringing, and you will see on the upper portion, that is a kind of chaotic beach, and then he picks up those pebbles and then brings a sense of order. Because without a sense of order, there can be no flow, or there is no design in the way the artist is conveying his ideas or thoughts in the work of art. Now, you must have seen this kind of newspaper ad, where it's about tenders and all that. The entire page is filled with information. You can't make out where to see, what to look for, and where is the most important point. But another page, there is a design involved. The along with the editor, the graphic designer will decide this is the most important item or news item today, and then accordingly they will give enough attention or enough font size for the main news. So the way it is designed, there is the flow that you have to see, and of course there are theories which go behind that you have to follow a Z pattern and all that while designing the page. But for a common viewer, it is made easy in the sense he knows what to spend more time on, what is the not important news and what is the side news and so on. And also from first page to the 10th page, if something is coming up in the 10th page, that means place-wise also it is pushed to the background, right? So this is the kind of what we call hierarchy. Hierarchy means this is important, this is not important. That is given by the designer in the newspaper design. But artists tend to do that by using all these principles in their work. And to do that, they also use the what we call golden rule, you know, the Fibonacci series, that if you have to divide the space like 60-40, not in the middle, and then again you cut that. So if you do that kind of division, you end up with this kind of conch form. That they say is the most beautiful form, or the kind of template that artists can use to compose. But not all artists believe in that, but this is one theory. And also the other important thing is knowing very well that these installations, site-specific works, will not remain for a very long time. Maybe a next big wave will wash them away, or somebody may come and then just step over that and it's gone. So this is one trend that you see in the art, that there are some kind of art which is being produced to survive for a long time, then it is made into an object, then it is shown and sold and all that. There's some kind of art which is very ephemeral. That means it won't survive for very long, but knowingly well, the artist is doing that. Now, one of the important rule of composing is this idea of finding a balance, whether it can be a symmetrical balance, that means both sides are very equal, or it can be asymmetrical one. Now, how does this work in principle? A symmetrical balance would become where the center is the most important attention point. Now, you see this Raphael's School of Athens, you will see that all the lines are going and ending up in the center. And these two people are the most important persons in this particular painting. So they get the utmost attention. And then what he has done is he has made subgroups here. There is one group here, there is one more group here, there is one more group here, there is one more group here, like that. But from each group, there is a kind of visual contact he builds up. Maybe somebody, one person from here will look that side, so your eye will go there. Then again, somebody will look here. So your eye keeps constantly moving, but in the bigger picture, the center is the most important point at which the power lies. The center is always in this kind of, so you will see if I analyze, then all the, and this was the time when this idea of using the perspective rule was very strong. Another work with a symmetrical balance. So you will realize wherever the artist needs to emphasize the person that is sitting in the or part of the painting, a most important person, then that person will be kept in the center. So that there is no ambiguity, there is no sense of competition between the other person, and the center person is the most important. Again, you will see there are subgroups here. One group here, second group, third group, fourth group, and between them, because of this hand, your eye will, you see this hand here, you will tend to see here. And then there's one more hand which is, being directed that side. So subtly the artist will connect the areas, but overall the center becomes important. Also, when you put up something in the center, it is the most static position. There is no movement for that point of attraction, and it also signifies a lot of power. So it just doesn't work only in Western works. It happens in the Indian imagery, Indian context also, because it's a universal kind of understanding of the visual language. So once you know that, anything you put in the center becomes very important, then you can decide what to do with that. Now, the other aspect of the symmetrical, this one is radial symmetry, where from the center, the movement starts going outward, or sometimes from outside it comes inside. So many artists, especially who work with tantric kind of theme, use that to bring this idea of a center of the person or center of soul and things like that. And then there is a lot of movement involved. And then you will see that in Raza's work, you will see in a lot of Buddhist mandalas. Buddhist, they draw huge drawings of mandala, where the idea is that from the periphery, from outside, you concentrate on the inside and you start traveling. So there is a lot of pathways to go and all that. And then some of these are painted on silk, some of them are done with color powder. And they take days together to do one mandala. And then after about 7-8 days, the entire thing is erased. So it's also about this idea of creation and destruction, which are part of the whole cyclical kind of nature of the creative cycle. And then you see similar kind of radial symmetry in the Rangoli pattern that you see around us. So once you start locating that, you'll start seeing them in many, many places. Now the opposite of that symmetrical balance would be asymmetrical balance, where things are not located in the center, the balances are tilted, and then that's why I put this in the edge as compared to the other image where it was in the center. Now you see this painting, the center is almost empty. There is one group here, second group here, and a third person. They are interconnected, but the center is almost empty, and because of that there is a sense of dynamism in the work. Dynamism because once you see here, then she is looking at this body, and then that person is looking at her, then you see this person. So the way the artist has designed the movement of the eye by using the light, what we call chiaroscuro light, your eye keeps moving from one end of the canvas to the other, and in that sense you will see all the details. So the artist would have, like how the newspaper designer decided that okay, this is important, this is secondary, tertiary. Here whatever is secondary is submerged in the shadows, and whatever is important is given lot of light. And also you will see that the artist is combining the places with a lot of verticals which are coming again and again. In fact, that is what giving a sense of stability also. So from here you will start seeing that there are lot of verticals which are connecting the space from one side to the other. This is another work which has a very asymmetrical kind of balancing in the composition, and you will see again there is one big group here with lot of people, and then there is one girl here who is getting all the attention from that side of the group. And then if you remove this red band here, something is missing. So that red band is what is in fact, you know, connecting in a way which is visual. Visual means you can see that red line, but there is another line which is not seen, that is the gaze. These two people looking at each other is creating another line which is invisible, and what is the red line is the visible line. So the artist create this kind of various strategies to connect from one area to another area, so that you don't miss out anything, and then the kind of allocation of spaces is justified in his sense of composition. And then you try and remove this chair from here, the canvas will look very empty. And again here you will see that there are many verticals, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, which are combining, and then they are moving from one side to the other. And especially Degas did lot of drawings before doing a final work, so he knew exactly how he is composing the work, and where you know, the viewer has to see, and where his attention should go, and all. So nothing in that sense in these two works are random. The artist would have decided the flow, the hierarchy, and all the movement that is happening there. So I spoke about this idea of dynamism when things are not in the center. This is one more very good example for that. You will see that this is a ship or a boat which is broken, and then they're all floating on a rafter kind of thing which is just made up from the wood pieces there. And you will see one dynamic diagonal line there. Is one more diagonal line here. The actual attention is this one more ship that is passing by. A lot of diagonals which are crisscrossing each other. If you put a tracing sheet on this and you start tracing the contours, you will see that they are clashing with each other, and thereby it gives a sense of dynamism. Anything that is vertical or horizontal is very restful. So these artists are trying to break that kind of stillness and then bring a movement into the work. And you will see another big triangle here. There's one line that is going there, another line. So you can start finding lot of little triangles which is also there. So all these are composed, in the sense the artist would have done lot of previous studies and sketches and all that to bring this kind of arrangement. Now what we should not forget is that these few works, I am looking at them and emphasizing only on the formal elements. But it is possible that we can go back to those paintings and look for the content and various other possible entry into the work, like how we did with Guernica. We looked at the work for the content and the formal elements, then symbolism and so on, that I am not doing here for the sake of convenience, so that we will emphasize this, the formal elements of these works. If you have enjoyed watching this video, please press like button. To see more such videos, subscribe to our channel.
Thank you.